drinking 15 other drinks. That's 4 drinks in 2 days.
Right.
Most people probably gonna do more than 4 drinks. That's already $60. If you do that times 4, that's $240. If I go, you can get 20 cigars with $200. $180. Sometimes even $150.
Oh, that's a dope smoke. Actually, yeah. Let me ask you something. What do you think of the comparison of when people say like pay for play or spending money for girls or traveling for girls as opposed to how much money dudes spend on clothing, sneakers, drinks, getting in the club, their cars, the whole nine yards, and it's all to fetch in girls that go to the club frequently in comparison to what dudes spend on traveling and what they spend on the rooms, the taxi, the taxis and everything. You know, whatever dudes spend when they travel, like the passport bros. How do you compare and contrast to that?
Well, let's start right here. If you're in the States, or I guess even outside the States, nowadays when dudes are buying stuff to impress women, they're getting $600 Gucci bills. You know, the Gucci belt is $600. They're getting $2,000 Louis Vuitton shoes. Y'all are buying fucking cars with 30% interest rates. You know, Challengers with a 30. Let's say it costs 40 grand, you're gonna pay 60 or 70. Why are you really doing it? To impress the women, right? I mean, I wouldn't pay damn near double the car in my right mind.
Right.
So, if you're saying, you're talking about value.
Yeah.
Because what I'm doing is cheaper. Let's say if I'm a nomad, let's say I was a stationary expat. I can fly to, let's say from the beginning, I fly to Kenya one way, 900 bucks, let's say, from Texas. 900 bucks. Then I get a $750 apartment that's really nice for that price in Kenya. $750 every month. Then, because that's already a $2,000 Louis Vuitton shoes.
Yes.
And I'm going to a whole experience. Like, I can tell stories about being in Kenya. What story are you going to tell me about the Louis Vuitton shoes? You're going
right.
to tell me about how you bought the shoes and it didn't guarantee you no pussy?
Nope.
All I got to do is show up in Kenya, be fit, have some sort of sex appeal, some level of attractiveness, and I can just walk through the mall and a chick will choose me while I'm eating my $10 meals.
Exactly.
This is the better option than pay for play. I mean, if you're doing pay for play in the States, yeah, you just blow it money.
Do you think it's true that if you have on high-end gear, Gucci, Louis Vuitton, Prada, and so on and so forth, you don't necessarily have to be in shape?
Bullshit. You got to be one hilarious motherfucker or one rich. You got to be able to back. Because if you, let's say you 400 or 500 pounds, you Rick Ross 10 years ago. If you was Rick Ross 10 years ago, and we know he wears designer stuff and all that, He has to be Rick Ross to pull that off. He has to have that status or that income to pull that off.
Right.
So, get in shape.
Yeah.
Start fasting. get on the carnivore diet. Or you can take it the old school way. Don't eat shit. Just drink water. I promise in a week you'll look completely different.
What do you think is the average success rate in the United States, given a city like Miami, New York, L.A., or even Las Vegas, of guys who frequent the club Friday and Saturday with a brand new $1,200 outfit to impress girls? What do you think the success rate is on average?
In Miami, I think they could probably smash one chick a week. In Dallas, I'm speaking from experience, you're not really going to have too much success. You might get one a month.
Have you ever been to a country where having expensive and name brand gear was actually beneficial?
No, because it looks like you're trying too hard. And if you do that in somewhere like Brazil or Colombia, somebody will take it up off of you.
Oh, I didn't want another one. No. I'm sorry. Yeah. I said I was good.
I think you misunderstood.
You misunderstood.
Yeah.
It's like I verified.
Well, I did this. All right. Anyway. So, as far as the quality of the women in your top three countries, would you like to name your top three countries?
Brazil and Kenya, top two.
Top two countries. No need for a third one. In those countries, the quality of women you can get with personality and masculine stature, as opposed to the United States, which you can get with spending money on name brand and gear and VIP sections and so on and so forth. Compare and contrast the quality of women you can get in the States with that approach as opposed to what you can get in these other countries. How do you make the comparison?
If you only had... he didn't want another
one. You sure?
No, I didn't. I'm sorry.
One more?
No.
So if you... Are you saying if you only use personality...
Right.
In the States and in the other countries.
Yes.
So if you only use personality in the States, man, you really have to have that game. See, I can't really say that in the States. Like, it takes a lot more than personality. The expectations are so high. Whatever persona you have to put up, because that's more than likely what you're going to have to do is put up a persona to get a certain type of chick. You're going to have to keep that up. And it depends on how exhausted you want to be with keeping that up. You know, I know dudes that lied about having three construction businesses just to smash the best chicks in town, and it was all bullshit. So that's what it would take to get a 9 in the States. Like, you would have to do, it's too much, it's not worth it. To get a 9 in Brazil, like a 9 that the locals would rate a 9, that's probably in a magazine somewhere a 9 or a 10, it's going to take similar to what it would take. And like, you're going to have more resources than the 8 that you would get in Brazil.
Right.
She's going to be not as materialistic, but they will be materialistic. Like, the more beautiful women get, especially with the internet, it's becoming now where everybody's going to be materialistic and want to be flown to Dubai. When I was in Paraguay, the most beautiful chicks I would get at, I would look at the Instagram and be like, yeah, this is not going to work because she all in Dubai and all that.
Right.
But
right.
I can get a chick just as beautiful. So there's two types of 9s and 10s. You have just 9s and 10s that are just beautiful, and then you have the Dubai 9 and 10. You can find them both in any country. You can find a Dubai 9 in Brazil, or you can find a regular 9 in Brazil that you can get just by smiling and waving at her and she finds you attractive. And you're not a fucking goofball when you talk to her.
Yeah.
You won't have no problem.
Do you believe that men who want to settle down and start a family should probably, based on what you just said, take the advice of keep quiet, find that hidden gem, find a good woman, start your life?
If you want to start a family, you need to go to a smaller town in any country.
Right.
Any country. In Brazil, you have a better chance of starting a family in Salvador than you do in Rio or Sao Paulo. Or even if you go to Lauda de Freitas, which is a city north of Salvador, you're not really going to see any foreigners over there at all. You have a better shot of doing that there, because in the bigger cities, it is more similar to how it is back home. But it's not similar enough to where I feel like, oh, it's no difference. But you just notice that there's a slight difference.
Do you believe that, of course, you probably already explained this before. Do you believe that black men in general have more challenging obstacles to get over to find a wife to start a family than other races of men?
Yes, but it depends on where you're at. So if you're black, I'm black. I had an issue in Sao Paulo with I had a specific group of women that were attracted to me sexually that would go from approach to the bedroom and then continue to talk after the bedroom. Those were white women in Sao Paulo. That's not what I chose, it just was what it was. The black women in Sao Paulo couldn't even approach them. They couldn't even hear me talking to them. But when I go to Salvador, I had no problem dating anybody. So the cheat code is, if you're a black guy, is to go, if you're in South America, let's say, go to a city where there's already black people in mass numbers that are doing well, or it's just black people in mass numbers. Cali, Colombia, Salvador, Bahia, Rio, you know, places like that, you won't really run into those issues. But that doesn't mean in Lima, Peru, where there's pretty much no black people, or Paraguay, where there's pretty much no black people, or Santiago, Chile, where there are black people, but they're immigrants, you won't have issues so much with race there as you would in a place like Sao Paulo. So it takes experience in traveling around. But most of you guys are not going to do what I do and travel to 46 cities in 2 years. Some people just want to go to one city. And that's why it's important to book a consultation or training to figure out what is right for you. We don't sell consultations just to talk on, because I don't feel like just talking to a bunch of people all day. I got my own stuff I want to do every day. But if you want that head start or that cheat code, you need to talk to somebody that's been there, that's been through the scenario, that's actually not just pay for play, that's actually went around and socialized with people on the street to realize, oh, in this area, these people behave this way towards me because of this, but in this area, they don't. Another example, Manaus, you're not really gonna see black people like that. That's in the Amazon in Brazil. Not once did I feel like I was black. Not once did I think being black limited my dating opportunities at all. Now, I had some scenarios where I noticed some favoritism with my white friends over me, but I didn't at once feel like I'm just shit out of luck over here.
Right.
But in Sao Paulo, yeah, you can have some moments where it's like, shit, like, the next chick that's digging me, I just probably need to stick with it.
Did they make you feel ugly?
You can't make me feel ugly because I have too much. My self-esteem is too high and I'm too confident.
That's positive.
But I could see, if you don't have my self-esteem, it could generate insecurities, which is what they already have in Latin America. When kids are at school, the black kids are told, your afro is ugly, your black skin is ugly, you're not the desired race, you need to marry up. That's why South America is so mixed. That's just like the United States, why South America imported a bunch of Europeans to whiten the population. Whenever Brazil liberated slaves, 80% of the population was slaves and the rest were the Portuguese. It's not like that anymore. You know, Argentina had a 40% black population whenever they liberated the slaves, and a lot of Argentine culture, like the tango dance, is derived from African roots. There's less than 1%. Less than 1% of Argentina is black now. So we can't deny this whitening the race, or whitening the population thing.
It's written.
It's in history books. I don't know why
it's
people
information
want to deny.
They can look up pretty much on the internet.
And they did the same thing in the United States. They did the same thing. It didn't work the same way. I mean, maybe it did, I don't know. But I do know that the Irish, the Italians, the Germans were imported to come work in the United States the same way they were in Latin America. Latin America is literally North America, just a southern version. South America.
Right, right.
There's some differences, but when you look at the history, they both had slaves, they both imported Europeans, but the difference is South America integrated rather than segregated. That's the reason why black Americans have more pro-black history than, like, who were the Black Panthers of Brazil?
Right.
They weren't any. There was no Black Panthers in Brazil. There was no civil rights in Brazil.
Through all your travels, how many countries have you been to?
25
countries. And the countries that you've been to where black men are appreciated, do you think that women are more interested in black men who have a thug style approach or a GQ style approach?
GQ. If you dress like a thug in Latin America, they'll be scared of you, because in Latin America, crime is fucking real.
Makes sense.
Like, they're not attracted. I mean, if you attract a Latina that by being this favela or barrio looking guy, she's probably a ghetto girl too. She's probably one of them. She's probably a criminal herself. But we know in the States, yeah, if you got some time on your record, you got some extra points in the dating game. In Latin America, it's not the same. You're not gonna be a thug dating a Brazilian politician. Now, you may be able to smash them. Of course, that's smashing means nothing. You know, these chicks will smash you. You can smash a fucking Ku Klux Klan member if you wanted to. That, but long-term commitment is something different. So to answer your question, no, you guys need to dress properly. Like, you got some damn sense when you go to places in Latin America. And in Africa. And I don't think... You know, I've seen Africans try to imitate the thug stuff. I don't really think it helps their dating apps. I don't know why they do that. I don't think it helps.
With the wedding, the guys imitating Bloods and Crips with the whole leaning thing?
Yeah, that... Those African chicks find that funny. I don't think they find that like, oh, like, it makes me want to give them some head now. I don't think they look at it like that. Now, in America, yeah.
The damage that's been done to the black male image, you know, the things that you've been dealing with, the things you've noticed and recognized throughout your travels in the United States, in the UK, what's going on in the UK and everything, do you believe that it is unfixable? Do you believe that with certain move and certain efforts that our image can be respected to the point where being black is a thing of the past? If you're a good dude, you're a good dude. If you look good, period.
Yes, it is. We probably won't see it in our lifetime, so probably towards the end of mine.
What do you think it will... Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Well, if you look at the United States, we did that when we fought for civil rights, and then we had more support. I don't know if I can say that. I was about to say we had more successful blacks now than then, but back then we had our own communities and we did well by ourselves. But our image is more positive in the States now as opposed to it was 100 years ago. So it is easier to date a white woman in Texas than it was in the 40s, where you probably get lynched, you know, for doing, there was a worse image back then. But it could be fixed. It won't be next year. It won't be 10 years from now either. It'll take probably 40 or 50 years. But it's up to y'all to quit posting pay for play women. That doesn't help the image.
Do you believe that there is a kind of a dynamic in a way to look at pay for play and marriage in the West, that the two kind of intertwined in a way?
They can be similar, because a wife, and I've never been married, obviously, but from what I know, in a matter of common sense, keeping a wife is not free. And in America, if you lose your wife, it costs. It costs more than what you would spend on paper, but I haven't been married, so I can't answer that. I don't have that experience in that field yet.
If you have someone who understood marriage as a business, and a lot of people have made this statement that marriage is a business.
Kevin Samuels did.
Kevin Samuels has made the statement. Do you believe that if prostitution becomes legal in the United States, that would be the way to go instead of marriage?
I don't know if it'd be the way to go, but I've made this statement myself many times where I said that if prostitution was legal, a lot of issues we have in the States wouldn't exist. Like the whole sexless marriage thing.
Right. You don't think that's the same thing?
That's not. Well, here's the thing. That's not happening in Brazil because, oh, my wife doesn't want to have sex with me? That's a whorehouse down the street for $50. We don't have that option in the States, so we have an influx of simps or dudes that just are too afraid to lose half of their stuff.
Right.
So they deal with it.
Do you think if you get married, does that automatically make you a simp, even if the woman is good to you?
Absolutely not.
Fair enough.
Absolutely not, because I've done the player lifestyle now around the globe for 2 years, and eventually I'm going to get burned out, and I'm going to want one chick it may be here and there smash on the side, but I'm gonna be more open to that, and I wouldn't be opposed to being married. No.
What do you think of men who get into marriages and find out 5 or 10 years down the road that their wife has fallen out of love with him, she's disrespecting him, but to divorce her is going to cost him more than he can handle, financially can handle. So, in a result, the wife starts sleeping with other people, she starts seeing other people, she starts going out a lot, and he's still tethered to her, and in that sense, he looks like a simp on paper. How do you break that down?
Involuntary simp.
Could you tell us more about that?
Voluntary simp is, I don't really have any personality, so I'm just gonna throw money at this chick to right. get her to love me. Involuntary is like what you're describing. Like, I'm in this situation. If I know she's dogging me out, but if I try to get out of it,
right.
if I try to not be a simp for this situation, I can lose my stuff. I could be on child support, alimony, you know, all of that.
What do you think is the main passport bro creator in the United States?
Creator?
The main thing that men deal with in the United States, number one overall, is what creates your average passport bro, especially black men.
Masculine women.
Masculine women.
I would say masculine women first and then marriage laws.
What do you think creates masculine women?
Women do what the men allow them to do, and it the culture.
So simps create masculine women.
Well, I'm gonna say this: the culture is created by government. You go to Saudi Arabia, a woman, let's say 2013, when they couldn't drive.
Right.
Do you think that woman is treating a man like she doesn't need him? She can't even get in a fucking car and go nowhere without him. You know, they're not supposed to, from what I've seen, I'm not a Muslim, but I know that they're not supposed to be in the same room as another man without their husband being there. So those laws, or those religious laws, I guess you should say, that creates the culture. In the United States, women have government assistance.
Yep.
They have the marriage laws and their benefits. They have the Me Too. They have all this stuff that... Why would they respect you?
They're paid to get a divorce.
Why would they respect you?
Right.
The same reason in Brazil where prostitution is legal. Why would I simp over one chick? I'm not desperate for sex. I could pay for that if I wanted. But in the United States, we don't have that option unless you live in Vegas.
So how does a man create a family in the United States with all these obstacles and all these negatives surrounding them?
Pray to God that you find one that won't put you in that situation.
Do you think,
if I had the answer to that, I wouldn't be where I'm at right now.
Do you think it's almost common sense for a man to leave America and create a family in another country?
You can survive in most countries for 15, besides women, you can survive in most countries for $1,500 and you would be in upper middle class or upper class. If you go to Cambodia and you're making $2,500, you're doing better than 95% of the people there. So why not put yourself in the most advantageous situation and be in a place where the marriage laws are in your favor and prostitution is legal, so the whole sexless marriage thing of them weaponizing sex against you is less likely to happen?
Are there countries where a simp is safe?
What do you mean by that?
Are there countries that a simp in the United States is safe to find love in another country without worry about repercussions?
No, because there are vulture women everywhere, like Thailand. Like, there's women in Thailand that are aware that there are a bunch of foreigners that have no social awareness, no real charisma, they don't know how to love or please a woman. They have nothing. And they'll present themselves in the best manner to you just to get over on you. We've seen that happen multiple times in multiple different countries. So, to answer your question, I think a simp's safest place is the United States. And I mean, that's not ideal for him as well, but simping is a choice, or it's a behavior that you don't know that you have, because most of us were raised by simp. For example, my mother told me, the stuff she used to tell me on how to treat women, I thank God I had my brother and my uncles that told me the other side. Now, I'm not saying it's her fault because she's a woman and she's going to tell me what she would want a man to do.
Right.
But you also can't believe women. The stuff that they tell you, you shouldn't do it. You know what I mean? So if you take a woman's advice, usually it's going to steer you in the wrong direction.
So female dating coaches is a bad idea.
Most of them are con artists.
Yeah. What do you say to the hopeless simp? What do you say to the hopeless simp? A simp that just can't get right.
What do I say to a man that just doesn't understand that throwing money at women and kissing a woman's ass for anything and she can do no wrong? Keep doing what you're doing and learn the hard way. Because we're putting out content to tell you guys the right way and how it is in other places. But if you can't learn through us and you want to gaslight us, because the simps gaslight us too. Most of them don't even like women, but they gaslight us as well. Find out the hard way. Go through divorce court, go through child support, and find out the hard way.
The whole term passport, bro, has been tossed around. And a word in itself has taken on its own animal, and there's been numerous people that have represented the tag in ways that is not exactly representational of what the original definition of it was. To get people back on track, for all of us, could you define what a passport, bro, is?
You know, I don't know the exact definition, but I think an ideal definition would be a guy that's going where he's treated best. Whether that's with women, his quality of life, the type of food he eats, because we know the food in the States is processed to oblivion. You know, what do you want? It's a man that has a problem with it, because it's not just the United States. Let's say he's in England or Canada or the United States, and he can't find that in his country. But he realizes if he travels, he can get what he wants, whether that's a wife, quality of life, or the food he eats, anything.
If someone leaves the United States, moves to somewhere like Colombia, Brazil, or Thailand, and they build a life there and never return to the United States, meet a girl and start a family, does that automatically make them a passport, bro?
No.
Okay.
No, because long before this was a term, military men were doing this, white men were doing this that weren't in the military, you know, students that went overseas to study and figured out that they liked that area better, probably never came back.
So is it fair to say that they maybe fall under the definition of what a passport bro is, but don't necessarily call themselves passport bros, given that it is a new term?
Yeah, they can become a victim. They have to state, they have to make sure that they state that they're not one of those guys.
Clearly, it means that they may not be passport bros, but they're pretty much doing the same thing as what the original definition of a passport bro was.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it's fair to say that we could technically say that you're not a passport bro, but you're basically doing the same thing. Is that fair?
Yeah. Like, for example, my thing was not just women. It was social life in general, which included men and women. We've been hanging out all day, every day for the past couple weeks. You know, I didn't have that same freedom in the States because it's an individualistic culture in the States. And my money goes a lot further, so I have a lot more free time. And more than likely, to do this, you either had to have remote income or you had to be rich or have some sort of investment that doesn't require you to be there.
Basically, you have a lot of knowledge and travel knowledge as far as how to deal with all the dynamics of being a single young man traveling all these countries as a black man and everything. Is it safe to say that what you teach people can fall under the category as teaching people how to transcend race and just be accepted in any country where they go and kind of overcome those setbacks?
I don't prefer to overcome anything. Like, I don't prefer to change anything. You know, for example, like when we're here in Turkey, you know, some chicks have said, like, hey, like, they do like us here, but they don't want to be seen in public with this because of society. I'm not here to change that. What did I tell y'all? Go to Kenya. That's not a thing over there.
Is Kenya really the new Brazil?
Brazil's hard to replace, man, but for me, when we talk about the amount of bullshit you deal with, I think Kenya has less. So for me, I wouldn't say it's a new Brazil, but it's just the African Brazil for me.
What are some pluses that Brazil has that Kenya literally does not have?
Racism. Some people say they have tribalism, but guess what? I was born in Texas. I'm not part of any Kenyan tribe.
Right.
I don't think I would fall under... I don't even speak Swahili. You know, so I don't think tribalism would affect anybody at this table. And if anything, if we're part of any tribe, we're going to at least be part of the upscale tribe when we go over there. You know, we're going to be advantageous side.
In Kenya, bringing in $55,000 a year, U.S. dollars, mm-hmm. living in Kenya, mm-hmm. is the equivalent of making how much money to live the same level and status in a city like Houston?
It would be I would multiply it by five.
Multiply it by five.
Because if you break that down, it's about $4,583 per month, I believe it's $4,583.
Right.
You can stay, the one bedroom I'm looking at right now in Nairobi is $750 a month. That same one bedroom in that same area in Dallas would cost you $3,000.
Do you normally, walking out and about in Nairobi, do you constantly see possible business ideas or business opportunities everywhere you go? Is it like obvious? What would you say the number one business opportunity that you see very in your face and very available in Nairobi, Kenya for black men?
Everything. Nairobi is underdeveloped. Africa in general is underdeveloped. So you have real estate. I mean, look at the Chinese. Look at what they're doing. They're building hospitals, you know, schools, toll roads. Any opportunity that there is, it's there. I don't give a damn if you want to open up a call center. There's plenty of people in Nairobi that need that job.
How well do they speak English there?
Perfect. The homeless people speak perfect English.
How's the nightlife?
Perfect. Food? Seven days a week. Food, perfect.
Style?
Perfect. I mean, I think Nairobi women are the best dressed women I think I've seen in every country I've been to.
Beauty level?
Well, I know some of y'all don't like black women.
In comparison to Brazil?
That's why, so this is where these two kind of clash, because African women don't go to the gym. Brazilian women live in the gym. So if you value fitness, that's where Brazil has won over Kenya. If you value natural beauty and no makeup, you wouldn't like Kenya, because a lot of women do wear weave and makeup. I don't have a problem with those things. I mean, now you need to be the same skin tone as your hand, because I done seen some chicks that look light skinned. I seen them in person. They was darker than me. I don't like that, but
that's strange.
It's very,
I would not like
it's
that.
Almost mental illness level. Something's got to be wrong with you to pull that
off. See that a lot?
I've seen it more in other African countries, but when I was in Nairobi, I didn't see it as bad, but I did see it.
That's a question a lot of people don't want to answer. What about, on average, the hygiene of the women in Kenya? How well do they keep themselves up?
You can eat them. You can eat them if you wanted to, with no problem.
Brazil?
Now, I wouldn't recommend you do that, but you can.
Brazil?
You can eat them as well.
Okay.
So when it comes to vaginal hygiene, that's the ultimate tail factor. Can you put your mouth on it? If you can't put your mouth on it, it's not clean.
One more question. If you were to say that if someone is going to leave the United States, tell us about the things most important that they need to consider before they make that move permanently.
You need to actually really know your why. Why are you doing this? Are you doing this because Austin Holloman told you to? or are you doing this because you had an issue, you got on YouTube and my videos popped up, and I'm saying exactly what you need to hear? For me, when I got on YouTube and I was like, you know, maybe I want to try dating in Brazil. Let me see what the social life would be like in Brazil. And the first video I seen was this white guy. The story that he described on a couple of dates that he went on was like, that's what I'm looking for. I went down there. That's what I experienced to the point where I fucking cried. I didn't want to go back. I held a girl at the train station for 15 minutes because I knew it wasn't going to be there when I got back to Dallas. So then the second time I went, I said, okay, now I got to figure out how can I move here. The third time I went, I never came back. That's what I really wanted. Is it, because it's not pay for play. I don't see myself moving to another country just because it's more affordable to pay for sex. Does it make you happy? That's why I said cost of living, your health, and your social life. Women, or just social life in general.
They say too much pay for play can make you hate women. Do you think that's possible?
It can make you objectify them and feel like they're not people. Because those dudes that advocate pay for play, why would I go on a date? It's going to cost more. It's going to cost my time. You ain't doing shit with your time anyway. So that don't even matter. Why do I prefer to go on dates rather than do pay for play? Yes, I am spending more time. She's going to be wetter. I'm going to have an actual attraction to her. I can call her again. I can enjoy my time with her and feel fulfilled with myself. I'm not going to feel fulfilled knowing that this chick just got wore out before somebody else, or she's about to go get wore out after me. It's too transactional. Some of you guys like transactional. Go ahead.
What is a country you're really, really curious about that you believe that may be very interesting to you to go to visit?
I'm going to have to say Madagascar and maybe somewhere like Angola. And I say Angola because I speak Portuguese, and I would like to see if the experience with social life is similar to what it is in Brazil, because that's where Brazil got their slaves from. So a lot of Brazilian culture is like samba, comes from Africa, comes from Angola. They used to do samba. Is there a connection with the way how people behave there and to Brazil?
You plan to go soon?
I am. They just need to lower them flight prices. I would have already went by now.
Yeah, I feel you. My man Austin.
$900 one way, no matter what part of the continent you come from. You could be next door. You could be in Namibia, and it's going to cost you an arm and leg to get over there. All
right, man. You still consider yourself a passport, bro?
It's still tatted on my arm. I don't regret it.
I see the tattoo. There it is, man.
The only reason I disassociated myself is because of you pay-for-play guys and creep cam guys. When they wrote my article in Brazil, they put stuff that y'all did in my article. So I was like, oh, it's not that I don't support the ideology. I just can't be responsible for y'all. Now, if it was Kappa Alpha Psi, where there's rules and there's membership fees and there's you can get kicked out and we can disown you, then yeah, I would have never. It would be perfect. But it's not that.
All right, man. That's going to wrap this up, man. It's a good interview, man. My man, Austin. Y'all heard him. I asked the questions that everybody really wanted to know. Y'all know me. I don't play around when I ask questions. I ask details. I qualify stuff. He answered everything. Didn't blink. Didn't hesitate. Answered everything straight up. So y'all go ahead and comment and like and subscribe. All right, everybody.